but it's always good to come back. The minister to the Peter and Keith. So the collection's taken after the sermon. So there's a good sermon you put more in. Keith Weir. Okay, delighted to see you all.
Well, thank you for that lovely welcome, James. It is great to be here in Cymru today. What a wonderful place and what a wonderful day we've got for it. To be able to praise God together in his wonderful, wonderful location. Of course, today is the fourth of our United Summer Services. We've been at different places in the past, the Pigeons and the Keeler. Last week was St Andrews, this week Cymru. Next week we're in Freecombe, at Freecombe Pub. And I just want to say a couple of things so you know what's going to be happening at Freecombe next week. Those of you who know Freecombe Pub will know that it's not a huge place, so there are some preparations that we need to do. When you arrive in Freecombe, parking isn't going to be in abundance, but we do have permission to use the car park for the Masonic Lodge, so feel free to use that one. There is parking at the hub, but only probably for about 20 odd cars, am I right, Alan? But there's plenty of space either on the main street or if you can find space on one of the back streets. So we should be okay for parking, and it certainly shouldn't be any further to walk than you might normally do on a Sunday morning anyway. So find a place where you can, but you can park in the Masonic Lodge car park next week. The service, of course, starts at 10:30 as usual. Now, I'm putting out an appeal just now, because there aren't enough seats in the hub. So we're going to need to take some seats from Freecombe Church Hall along to the hub, and possibly from Invercargill Church Hall as well. So is there anybody with a van who might be able to help probably next Saturday or possibly even Sunday morning? If it's not you, or if not a van, then somebody with a trailer, just so we can get the chairs and make sure it's all set up. If that's you, could you get in touch and we'll make sure that one way or another we'll manage to make sure that there's enough seating. Another question, this is a question that there's one or two of the session clerks here. Could I just gather you together with a quick question to ask you? Because obviously one of the things that we need to do next week is to make sure we've got adequate music. So if I could just gather you quickly just to take a view on something before we go. This week's service, as James said, shared by myself and Keith. I'll be taking the first part of the service, and then during the second or the third hymn, I'll be passing the microphone over to Keith to continue, and Keith will finish the service off. Hopefully you should have a printed order of service. There were some large print ones. If you're struggling, there are some large print at the back. I'm sure we can find a way to get a large print to you if you need it during the service. But let's then worship God together with the bidding of the psalmist in our ears. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his love endures forever. The Lord is with me. He is my helper. So we sing together with one heart, mind, soul, and voice of praise. Praise my soul, the King of Heaven.
Thank you.
Let's come before the Lord in our prayers. Let's pray. God of unity and peace, we come before you into this place, this beautiful place, with our hearts filled with adoration and praise. You are the one who shines above all, who is through all, and is in all. And this day, together we rejoice in your infinite wisdom and grace, which are evident in the unity and diversity of your living body, the Church, bringing your mystery to the world. You have given us apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers to equip us for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God. You have given us food providers, home visitors, listeners, agitators, and musicians, as those gifted into the work of service, as the manifold, multifaceted blessing for a world in need. You have given us givers, administrators, financial specialists, property experts, and cleaners, and many others to enable our service in your name to be effective, that the name of Jesus may be praised. We marvel at your plan for us to grow together in maturity, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ Jesus. You call us to live a life worthy of the calling we have received, with all humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another in love and striving to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. And yet, O Lord, we confess that we often fall short of this calling. We have not always been humble, gentle, or patient. We have been tempted to allow anger, bitterness, and discord and envy to seed suspicion within us. We have spoken words that do not build up, but tear down. We have neglected to put off our old selves and to put on the new self, created to be like you in true righteousness and holiness. Forgive us, O Lord. Renew our minds and hearts through your Spirit. Help us to that kindness and compassion for one another, that with forgiven hearts for each other, we may reflect the heart that you have for us. So just as in Christ Jesus you forgave us, teach us to speak the truth in love, so that we may grow to become, in every respect, the mature body of him who is the head, the Savior, Christ Jesus, our living Lord. May we no longer live in the futility of old, estranged thinking, but be made new in the attitude of our minds, putting off falsehood and speaking truly, for we are all members of one body. Enable us, then, in word and action to build up the Church, that we may reflect your perfect plan and your boundless love and grace to the world. Bless us then as we say together the prayer of your whole Church. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The first reading is from Ephesians Ephesians chapter 4, reading verses 1 to 16. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he took many captives and gave gifts to his people. What does he ascended mean, except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. So Christ gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers to equip his people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God, and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves, and blown here and there by every wind of teaching, and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Thanks be to God for these readings, this reading from his holy word, and to his name be all honor and praise.
Thirty years ago this year, I left college, junior college. So I brought my college sweatshirt with me. It used to fit. I think it has shrunk, yeah. I'm not saying I haven't got bigger, but I think it's shrunk as well. But I think you probably wore it once or twice, Rona. One time. But on the front, it's got our college crest, Northern College, Manchester, with angels each side of the crest. And underneath, there is a motto, or a phrase in Greek. So it's Eis Ergon Diakoniat. Eis Ergon Diakoniat. And that actually comes from our reading today. It's Ephesians 4, verse 12. And that was our college motto back in Manchester. I'm going to put that one just on there. Now, once a year, when I was at college, we used to do what we called a mass preach. So a number of different students from the college, we would all take a weekend to go away somewhere, and we would preach in a number of local churches all on the same morning. It was our way of, in a sense, showing that we were part of the life of the wider church. And on one occasion, we went up to Northumberland. So I got to preach at that time in a church in Northumberland. Incidentally, that was the very first time I ever went to Scotland, because we were literally just over the border. So somebody said, well, let's just nip over the river so we can be in Scotland. So that was my first time in Scotland. Well, one of the things that we used to do was on the Saturday evening, we would have a kind of a get-together, and people from the local churches would be invited to come and to meet the students and to ask questions. This may be apocryphal. It was before my time, but it was always a story that was told that there was one student that perhaps wasn't that great at Greek. Now, I passed my Greek literally just, I got 50%, the pass mark is 50%, And it was enough for me to say, yes, you've passed, but for my tutors to say, but we won't make you do it again. So I think that was probably a win. So some were better than me, others perhaps not quite so much. And there was one student that perhaps wasn't quite as familiar with his Greek as perhaps he could have been. And the story goes that he was asked at one of these gatherings, what does your college motto mean? Eis ergon diakoneas. And he said, I'm not really sure, but I think it means to urge on the deacons. It actually means for the work of service. So for the work of service. I actually thought, well, to urge on the deacons, I actually quite like that. Because that encouragement to serve, that's an important part of what it means to be the fellowship of a church. It's part of what it means to be a gathered community coming together to support each other and to enable each other and to dwell together as one in faith. The church isn't just an individual, we have to be together. It's the gathered people of God together that make the church. So if we urge each other on, if we encourage each other, that's actually part of who we should be as the church. But of course, that's not quite what Paul is getting at. Eis ergon diakoneas, for the work of service. This is about encouraging each to participate using the gifts that God has given to them. So Paul lists a number of different gifts that he wants to encourage in the church, but which he wants people to use to encourage others in the church. So he talks about pastors and preachers and teachers, and these different aspects of the life of the church. But of course the church is so much more than that. Encouragement is certainly a gift. Preaching is a gift. Teaching is a gift. So is flower arranging, and so is playing the music. So incidentally, thank you very much for playing to us today, Alison. I've always thought Alison's ministry of music is such a gift in the praise of God. And I've always been very grateful for Alison and for all of the other musicians that lead us on a Sunday morning. We have so much that goes on in our lives as part of the church. We all have our own service to give. We all have our own service to bring that we can together build up the life of the church. And Paul speaks about how it's the whole church together, bringing all of the gifts that God has given us together in the Spirit that enables us to serve. So I don't have to do everything, you don't have to do everything, but together we complete everything. We approach to the fullness of what God has given us. So together we move into the work of service. We work for the work of service, that the world may know that God is living, that Jesus has been raised, that together we have that gospel message of unity and peace, that mystery which we are called to share with the rest of the world, that message which is the greatest message that any of us can know, that Jesus truly loves us and he loves the world. What a wonderful message that is. And we do it when we serve God together. Let's sing. And we're going to sing the second of our familiar ones to you all, I'm sure. Jesus loves me. This I know.
Thank you.
The second reason for reading is continuation, also from Ephesians chapter 4, reading from verses 17 to 32. So I tell you this, and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding, and separated from the life of God, because of the ignorance that is in them, due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they've given themselves over to sensuality, so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. That, however, is not the way of life you learned when you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught, with regard to your former way of life, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. Anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Thanks be to God for the study of his holy word, and to his name be all glory and praise.
Let's all sing together. Jesus put the song in. Feel free to just do it, but remember the hey at the end. Jesus put the song into our hearts.
Amen.
And so this morning I want to think in terms of from the old to the new. From the old to the new. And this morning we come to the second part of Paul's letter in the church to Ephesus. It was headed, Unity in the Body of Christ. Unity in the Body of Christ. And this is a chapter of challenge. It's not just written to believers in Ephesus, but it's also a challenge for every believer. It's a challenge for us to be more like Jesus. When you meet the mum or dad who have had a new child, how often do you go along and say, I can see the resemblance, or they look very much like? You say that? And we've got to reflect Jesus in all we do and all that we say. Because in the earlier chapters of the book of Ephesians, it looked at the wonderful blessings that we receive through Christ. And now Paul's beginning to expand on this, and he's beginning to explain how the church is a body. He's illustrating the unity and purpose and showing how each individual must work together. And so we've got the importance of working together as part of the body of Christ. And so let's hear what Paul has to say again. I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble, gentle, be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. And so Paul was writing this letter while he was a prisoner in Rome. We can almost hear the passion in his voice as he writes, I urge you. There's an urgency here that Paul wants to get across to the church in Ephesus. And he wants to be the Ephesians and all those who read his letters to live a life that's worthy of the calling we have received through Jesus. But we've got to examine ourselves and we've got to ask ourselves, do we have any of these characteristics that Paul has mentioned? Humility, gentleness, patience, love, peace. I can just imagine you're probably thinking, that's easier said than done. Perhaps we're thinking, it all depends on the circumstances. But Paul's calling us to unity of the church and a oneness in Jesus. Jesus humbled himself, didn't he? He humbled himself to a manger. When he's in Philippians chapter 2, verse 7 and 8, we read, but he made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself. He became obedient to death, even death on a cross. And so these attitudes of humility, gentleness, patience, love, and peace, they're fostering a unity amongst Christians, coming together as one. And I'm sure you'd admit that as a church, we've come through a period of major changes. And so it's important that we learn to work together in unity. Because Paul emphasizes in verse 4, there is only one body, one spirit, just as you were called to one hope, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all, and through all, and in all. And so you see the unity that Paul is expressing here about the oneness of Jesus, bringing us together as a fellowship. Yes, we may have come from many different backgrounds. We may have different ways of doing things. But what unites us is God's love for each one of us. We've come to worship together. We've come to learn together. This idea of togetherness is being emphasized again and again in these verses. But we've got to acknowledge that Jesus is the cornerstone. He is the one at the centre of the church. He's the one that's the sure foundation. He's the one that wants to build his church up, one step at a time. And so it's important that we listen and we follow the Master Builder's clear instructions, one step at a time. But God's not expecting us to do it in our own strength. But in verse 7 we learn, to each one grace has been given as Christ has apportioned it. And so we learn that we've been given a gift as Christ has given us. And why have we been given gifts? Verse 12 reminds us to prepare God's people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. And so we're encouraged to build one another up in the body of Christ. And however much we try being more like Jesus, situations always seem to get in the way, don't they? Now, I know we're in the country, but we can illustrate things as Paul did by living by the sea. We're familiar how rough the sea can be, and how quickly a storm can arrive, and it becomes very dangerous. I remember when Ian and I were with Gideon's, we had responsibility for branches from Dundee up to Shetland. And the people in Shetland said we'd never travelled to Shetland unless we'd gone by boat. Well, you can fly up to Shetland from Aberdeen in next to no time, but the boat takes over 12 hours at night from Aberdeen all the way around and up to Shetland. So we thought, right, we've got to do it because you've told us that we've never come to Shetland unless we've taken the boat. So they're on the boat, departs from Aberdeen Harbour, nice and calm, I think. Great, we're going to have a nice sail up to Shetland. Gets out into the North Sea. And boy, oh boy, what a different story in the North Sea. This big ferry, buffeted about by the waves. Things that were on the shelf in the cabin started rolling down the floor. Up and down. And you look out, and all you see is the sea, but we're buffeted by the waves. And we know that through life, we too can be buffeted by all sorts of things that try to creep in on our life. But Paul was very much aware of all the temptations in and around Ephesus. He was aware of the false idols, the different cultures, the different traditions, and the different ways of life. And so he's encouraging believers to grow in maturity and not be, as he said, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. He knew that we could be tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. And so that's why we've got to have that firm anchor on the rock, which is Jesus Christ. We've got to make sure that we're firmly anchored to the rock, who's Jesus, that we hold on to it during the storms of life, so that we don't drift away, keeping our eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. And then Paul then returns to the theme of growing in maturity with Christ as the head of the body, and the love that holds us all together. The second part of Paul's letter is entitled Living as Children of the Light. Living as Children of the Light. And so from verse 17, we have instructions on Christian living. He says to put off our old self and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Put off your old self, your old way of life. Put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. And so when we become Christians, we have a new life in Christ. Our old way of life, and the way we were doing our own thing before we knew Christ, living a life as we pleased, But once we come to know Jesus as our Saviour, we want to become more like him. We want to please him. Remember the old hymn that used to say, to be like Jesus, to be like Jesus. All I ask, to be like him. How often are we reflecting Jesus in the things we do, in the things we say? Because his beauty has got to be seen in us. Because in Corinthians, Paul wrote in chapter 5 of the second book, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. Isn't it wonderful to think that as soon as we come to know the Lord Jesus as our Saviour, we've been recreated. He's working on us to make us this new creation that he wants us to be. But towards the end of the chapter that we read this morning, Paul's giving us clear instructions or guidelines on Christian conduct. And Paul's advising us against lying, uncontrolled anger, stealing, unwholesome talk, bitterness, rage. And what he's doing is encouraging kindness, compassion, forgiveness. In other words, he's asking us to walk worthy of our calling, to be imitators of God. Those of us who watch our children grow up, you know how they love to copy, they love to imitate the things that we do, the things that we say. We've got to do that with the Lord Jesus, don't we? We've got to be more like him in the things we do and the things we say. Because Paul's mentioned at the very start of the next chapter the things that it's going to be like as we move on in our Christian walk. And so this is a letter of encouragement for each one of us. But it's also a letter of making the Christian believers look at their lives, to examine themselves and see where they need to change. And so it's a challenge for us today. Because it wasn't just for the time when Paul wrote it to the church in Ephesus, but it's for us today. It's a call for us to look at ourselves, to examine ourselves, and say, am I more like Jesus day by day? Is the beauty of Jesus living in me? We have to take off that old self. We have to make sure we put on the new self. Or is there still something that we're holding on to? We like the way things used to be. We like the way things were always done. Perhaps God's calling us to get rid of it, to change, and to move forward as one body, serving the Lord Jesus Christ where we are. But we know that no human is perfect. But to become more like Jesus, we do need to change from our old ways. We can't do it ourselves. We need to be willing to allow God to change us. And if we're holding on to anything that displeases God, then Paul reminds us, don't grieve the Holy Spirit of God, for whom you have been sealed for the day of redemption. If we're holding on to something, we're not following the Lord Jesus as we should. And so it says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. And so this morning the challenge is, are we grieving or are we pleasing God in our attitude and our actions? God forgives us as we ask for forgiveness, but he also wants us to forgive one another. And so let's ask God to help us to live a life worthy of our calling, to be the people that he wants us to be, so that people will see Jesus living in us, so that people will know whose we are and whom we serve, so that we will know that we belong to him. And so this morning, let's individually and let's collectively as a church ask ourselves, am I holding on to anything from the past that I know that should be rejected? Am I following Jesus as I should? Am I as close to Jesus as I should? Because we know that it's as we confess our sins before him, so he will forgive us our sins. And so this morning, let's make sure that we're those who are not grieving the Holy Spirit, because we want to be more like Jesus, day by day. Let's pray together. Our gracious Lord and loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that your word is a living word. We thank you that your word is a word that changes lives. And so we come before you this morning and we ask that you will help us to examine our own lives. And that you will help us to get rid of anything that may be hindering us being more like Jesus in the things we do and say. We thank you for the illustration of the body. We thank you for the way that we've come together, part of Arbroath and District Church of Scotland. Help us to be those who work together as one for the glory of the Lord Jesus in our communities, in whose name we pray. Amen. And now let's pray our morning offering to the Lord.
The elderly and the housebound. May they know your love surrounding them.
and that we remember them at this time. Perhaps there are those who are mourning the loss of a loved one. Draw especially close to them, speaking your words of comfort. But Heavenly Father, you've told us to remember those who are in authority. And so we pray for local and national government. Grant them wisdom in the important decisions they have to make. And remind them that they are answerable to a higher authority. And as we come before you in prayer, we pray for our world at this time. For the many areas of conflict. For the innocent people who are killed as a result of war. For families who've lost everything and are living in makeshift shelters. We thank you for the relief agencies who are reaching out, bringing comfort to those in dangerous situations, often risking their own lives. We think of those people who are suffering because of national disasters, some because of drought, others because of flooding. Many not knowing where their next meal will come from. But it can be so difficult for us to understand at times when we see the farmers making their crops, harvesting their crops in the fields. But we are aware, even in our own towns, there are those who are relying on food banks through no fault of their own. And so, Father, we thank you that there are the various agencies willing to help and support those in most need. Help us to be those who show love and kindness in action. We remember those who are unemployed and seeking work. May the door of opportunity open for them. So, Father, as we come before you this morning, we remember those who may be on holiday. May they have a time of rest and relaxation away from their daily routine and return refreshed and reinvigorated for the work that you've called them to. Heavenly Father, draw us close to you and to one another. May we be built up as the body of Christ in this community. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now let's stand to sing together again. One more step along the road, I go. blessing at the end. Gracious Lord and loving Heavenly Father, we just sung these words, and it's from the old I travel to the new. Keep me travelling along with you. So draw especially close to each one of us, and help us to know your love surrounding us. Help us to be more like you in all we do and say as we go from this place. May we know the beauty of Jesus in us. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and remain with each one of us now and until you come, in Jesus' name. Amen. Flowing through. God bless. Thank you.